Welcome back. This is Meet the Press. Our guest today is Assistant Treasurer David Bradbury. Good morning, Minister.
Good morning, Hugh.
Let's start with the mining tax. Is it going to bring in the $2 billion that it's budgeted to bring in this financial year?
Well, we've revised down our forecast, but we do expect that the mining tax will bring in $2 billion in the coming year and $9 billion across the forward estimates. Of course, there's been a lot of speculation about whether or not tax has been collected in the first quarter. I'd make the obvious point that I think we should all be making, and that is to say, let's not judge good public policy based upon a single quarter. Let's look at what this is going to mean into the future.
Mind you, $0. You say there's a lot of speculation. Are you denying the speculation? Have you got a number you can share with us about how much money has flowed into the coffers?
Well, we're not in the business of speculating on the tax bills of individual companies, and such is the nature of this tax that to start answering questions like that would be to go to the heart of particular amounts of tax that would be paid by just a handful of companies. Can I make this point, that this is a tax on mega profits? Where mining companies make mega profits, then the government will collect a fair share for the Australian people. Now, if the companies are not making mega profits, then we rely on the company tax that comes in the ordinary course. But that is what we've always said. That's why the claim that we've heard from the opposition day after day that this was going to destroy the mining sector has been such a furphy. In the end, where the companies are strong, we get a return. Where they're not as strong, we continue to get company taxes.
But as you say, you rely on mega profits to get money out of this particular tax, but you rely on this tax to deliver a surplus. If you don't get the $2 billion, you've currently got a budget surplus of $1.1 billion. You're not going to make that surplus, are you?
Well, look, we have, through both the budget and the media statement process, gone through and we've revised expenditure, we've revised these matters according to revised revenue forecasts, and we'll continue to manage the budget responsibly in that way. And that's something that shouldn't surprise anyone.
So if you're managing the budget responsibly, what have you got up your sleeve now? If this money's not coming in because the mega profits aren't there, or for whatever other reason built into the structure of that tax, what else have you got up your sleeve to meet that surplus, which you've attached so much to?
It's not about having something up our sleeves. Let's not forget that for all of the hot air in the political debate around this issue, the mining tax still accounts for less than 1% of Commonwealth revenues. So it is a small proportion of the overall contribution to government revenue. We stand by our estimates that there will be substantial revenue to be collected across the forward estimates. But notwithstanding that, through this budget process and the media statement, you've seen that we've taken some difficult decisions in relation to savings measures, particularly some of the long-term structural savings measures that will make sure our budget will be sustainable, not just for the next quarter or the next year or the forward estimates, but moving well beyond that.
If we don't get into surplus, will Australia lose its AAA credit rating?
Well, it's not as simple as that, but you make a good point. We have a AAA credit rating, not just by one or two, but all three of the major credit rating agencies. Fitch, once again, reaffirmed that on Friday night.
I think my point is that we keep the AAA regardless of whether we go into a surplus in this financial year. So why the obsession with the surplus in this financial year? There can be no economic imperative for that, surely.
You've got to keep working hard to run tight fiscal policy to maintain what we have today, AAA credit rating, first time in Australia's history, previous governments couldn't deliver it. Now, people that suggest to me that you don't need a surplus, I ask the question, well, how much of a deficit do you want? The point is, where the economy is returning to trend growth, where we have contained inflation, where we have unemployment at contained levels, and a record pipeline of continued investment, these are the circumstances where in which governments should be pulling back on their spending, should be returning their budgets to surplus to give the Reserve Bank the space that it needs to do what is so important to families and businesses, to cut interest rates. And that has benefited families and businesses considerably. If you've got a $300,000 mortgage, since we've come to office, you're now paying $4,500 less in repayments.
David Bradbury,
that's how you make a difference to families.
You were a Julia Gillard backer in the last leadership vote. Another Gillard backer, Simon Crean, said today that it was wrong, in fact, to chop down Kevin Rudd. Do you agree with that?
Look, you know, these matters have been canvassed comprehensively. What I will say is that we are Labor in government. We have the opportunity here to make history, not to just write about it. I'm determined to be a part of a government that's getting on with the job of doing things that will make a difference. Introducing a national disability insurance scheme, investing in education so every Australian child has the opportunity to realise their potential. And later today, we'll see from the Prime Minister, we're about ensuring that moving into the future, that we are able to build the opportunities and make them available for all Australians of an Asian century, so that we can tap into a shifting power of economic growth into our region, just so that all Australians can lift their living standards over time.
Just quickly, you in your seat of Lindsay had a 5%, more than 5% swing against you last time. You're holding on by about a 1% margin. Is there a single thing, and if there is, what is it, that you need this government to do to ensure that you are returned at the next election? What does this government need to do?
Well, I never think it's ever as simple as saying there's one single thing, but we have to be a good government. We are a good government. We are not only managing our budget and our economy better than just about any country in the world. We're a standout performer.
Is unity essential?
Not only do
unity essential? Next election without the leadership thing being revisited, with that thing being locked away? Is that a requirement?
Unity is always crucial. We have runs on the board. We've got more to do. But the thing that will set our government apart from the opposition moving into the next election is that we actually have a plan for the future. We are looking through the windscreen to see what opportunities exist rather than looking up through the rear vision mirror.
OK, David Bradbury, thank you very much for your time today. I know it's your twin's birthday, so thanks for your time.
Thank you, and congratulations to you, Hugh, and your team for 20 years of providing outstanding breakfast television for us all.
Thank you, I'll take that. Assistant Treasurer David Bradbury. Now, coming up, two men, they're both backbenchers, they're both just 2 years into their parliamentary careers, but they do carry big expectations. We're going to meet two potential prime ministers coming up after the break.